Checkers explains corruption.
There's been a lot of discussion recently about the powers of Congress to subpoena information, whether that's the president's tax returns or testimony from people who are involved in political scandals. What people might not know is we've already had these battles back in the 1920s during the Teapot Dome scandal. Let's talk about the presidency of Warren G. Harding. During the nomination process, Harding was asked whether he had any skeletons in his closet that would prevent him from being president. Harding said no. Put a pin in that. But when he goes to Washington as the newly elected president, he brings friends of his from Ohio, who later become known as the Ohio Gang. One of the members of the Ohio Gang was a man named Harry Daugherty, who had run Harding's presidential campaign. As president, Harding made Daugherty the attorney general, and Daugherty hired a man named Jess Smith to be his point person in the Department of Justice, even though he was never officially on the government payroll. Jess Smith was quite the colorful character. He had lots of different side hustles going on while he worked as the gatekeeper for the Attorney General of the United States. He was known to give illegal licenses for alcohol to bootleggers during Prohibition, and he left the impression that for enough money, he could make a DOJ investigation or prosecution go away. One of Jess Smith's schemes was essentially running a speakeasy out of a house on K Street, which is known as the Little Green House. His ex-wife, Roxy, later testified that there were many illegal actions at the Little Green House. One of the people who would show up at the Little Green House was President Warren G. Harding, who apparently liked to drink and liked to gamble. As it turned out, President Harding had at least two mistresses and one out of wedlock child. President Harding had a short but scandal-ridden presidency. He once said, "I am not fit for this job and I should never have been here." The Teapot Dome scandal gets its name from Teapot Dome, Wyoming, where a naval oil field was transferred from the Navy to the Secretary of the Interior. And then the Secretary of the Interior leased oil drilling rights to private companies in exchange for bribes. A separate naval reserve of oil at Elk Hills was also leased for bribes. Fall had fallen on hard times, and so he took a $100,000 bribe to allow drilling in Elk Hills. Secretary Fall also took bribes for drilling in Teapot Dome for $300,000. Shortly after he took these bribes, his neighbors in New Mexico noticed that he had improvements on his ranch, including new fencing and new cattle. Rumors of his new wealth made their way to Washington. About the same time in Wyoming, people noticed Sinclair oil trucks driving up to the previously off-limits Teapot Dome oil reserve, and word of that got to Washington too. The Senate investigated Mr. Fall and his newfound riches. Fall told Senate investigators that he got $100,000 from Ned McLean, the publisher of the Washington Post. And McLean actually backed up his story and lied to Senate investigators about the source of this money. McLean's story about being the source of the $100,000 that was really from an oil man who paid a bribe to Mr. Fall fell apart because Senate investigators had already looked at McLean's bank accounts, and they knew that he never had $100,000 in his bank. Later, Edward Doheny, the oil man who had paid the bribe, mischaracterized this bribe as a mere loan to Albert Fall. He also claimed that because he was so rich, giving this loan was akin to giving a loan for $25 or $50 for a normal person. Edward Doheny once said, "I'm just an ordinary, old-time, impulsive, irresponsible, improvident sort of prospector." But at the time of his bribe, his fortune was estimated to be $100 million. Senate investigators then turned their attention to Attorney General Harry Daugherty because he had turned a blind eye to the exploits of Secretary Fall. This also brought to light the fact that Daugherty and Jess Smith had a joint bank account at a bank that Daugherty's brother ran. Senators subpoenaed Daugherty's brother, Malley, and relevant bank records, including one for an account called Jeff Smith Extra Number 3. As investigations heated up around Jeff Smith, Harding lost faith in him. And rumor had it that Jess Smith was about to be arrested. So Jess Smith burned records that he had and then later killed himself. A few months after Jess Smith was found dead, Harding himself died unexpectedly on a trip to San Francisco. Harding's scandals outlived Harding. The new president, Calvin Coolidge, tried to distance himself from the scandal and appointed two special counsels to look into the Teapot Dome scandal. Meanwhile, the Senate was still interested in getting bank records from Malley Daugherty, Harry's brother. They subpoenaed Malley to testify before Congress, and they also subpoenaed bank records that would relate to Jess Smith and Harry Daugherty. Malley refused to comply. At the direction of the Senate, the Sergeant-at-Arms sent a deputy to Ohio to arrest Malley Daugherty for refusing to comply with congressional subpoenas. Malley was arrested, but he convinced a judge in Ohio to free him because he argued Congress did not have the power to arrest a citizen for defying a congressional subpoena. After he was freed, one of the Daugherty brothers, it's unclear whether it was Harry or Malley, burned the bank ledgers that had been requested by a Senate committee. But there was still an ongoing court case about whether Malley Daugherty could be compelled to testify before a Senate committee. That case went all the way to the Supreme Court. In McGrain versus Daugherty, the Supreme Court held that Congress did have broad subpoena power that had to be honored and that they could hold people in contempt of Congress. Harry Daugherty was indicted for graft relating to scandals outside of the Teapot Dome scandal, but perhaps because certain evidence had been burned, or for other reasons, he was never convicted. There was some accountability after the Teapot Dome scandal. Harry Sinclair, who had bribed Secretary Fall with $300,000 for drilling rights in Teapot Dome, Wyoming, ended up going to jail for contempt of Congress. There were eventually consequences for Secretary Albert Fall, who was convicted of bribery. Albert Fall was the very first person to be convicted for a crime that he committed while he was a cabinet member in the White House. Mr. Doheny never went to prison for the $100,000 bribe of Secretary Fall.
The results are at all in any way inadequate to make me entirely happy. It is because my friend of former days, Senator Fall, is not included in the verdict of the jury today. The jury today, by its verdict, has decided that it is not a crime for a man to help an old friend.
Hello, I'm Ciara Torres-Spelliscy. Here are some of the reforms that came out of the Teapot Dome scandal. So one of the problems that Congress kept on running into was the inability to get relevant records, whether that was through their general subpoena power or through requests. And so one of the reforms that comes after Teapot Dome is the Revenue Act of 1924. Which empowers chairs of the Ways and Means Committee to request any person's tax returns, and the IRS must comply with that. Another reform that was a post-Teapot Dome reform was the passage of the Corrupt Practices Act of 1925. At least on paper, this required more limits of money in politics and transparency of money in politics. But what would happen in the following 50 years is that this part of the law would essentially go unenforced.
Historians now estimate that the Ohio gang during the Harding administration cost the American public $2 billion in theft and graft.
This has been Checkers Explains Corruption. Thanks for stopping by.